Hey, it's Alex Radcliffe from Board Game Co., and today I'm doing a list of my top 10 Euro games. Now, Euro games in a specific category, because Euro games are so broad that picking my top 10 Euro games from amongst all the games I have, from all the games I love, would be, well, it would be a challenging task, and I'd leave so many out. So for today's list, I'm specifically focusing on those games with an economic nature, at least to some degree. Games where you turn this into that, where you convert that into this, where you put a worker down here to get more things, you acquire more goods, you build an engine. There are so many different styles of Euros, but today I'm focusing on that genre of Euros. And this list is in no particular order because, well, I love all of these games, and I'm sure I could order them. But I love all these games, and I didn't feel the need to put one over the other, at least not today. And I'll start off with Everdell, a game that I have talked about frequently. Everdell is a game that I really enjoy, and it's such a shame because this is a game that almost left my collection, or rather it did leave my collection before I had second thoughts and brought it back to my collection. And the reason for that is because my first play of it, while enjoyable, something about it didn't capture me. Something about it resonated a little off, and I think that's because in Everdell you start off feeling like the game is entirely too restrictive, that you cannot do enough in this game. You place a worker, you get a good, you trigger a card, and before you know it you're into the next season, and then again the next season, and then again the next season, and before you know it the game is over. But while the game starts off feeling way too restrictive, by the time you actually get into the game, by the time you get to the end game, you begin to realize that in fact it is not too restrictive. Rather, in fact, you can do far more than you ever thought was possible, and the engine you built was attempting to get every ounce of goods out of the game while not maximizing for points because you just didn't think you'd be able to. So that first game of Everdell, at least that first game if you don't know that, can be a bit different than usual. But my second game of Everdell, when I had second thoughts, when I got it back, my gosh, I loved this game. The art is beautiful, the components are gorgeous, the world pulls you in. This is Redwall in a game. This is the exact contrast to Root. Root is the combat side of Everdell. Root is the combat side of Redwall, versus Everdell is the economic back end of Redwall. It has that aspect of, it pulls you in, it pulls you in thematically, but the gameplay is tight and rewarding as well. Every additional play I have played of this game since that first game has been incredible, and that is why Everdell is one of my favorite Euro games. From there, I'm going to go into Food Chain Magnet, a game that I just covered last week in my list of top 10 worst value for your dollar games, and while many people understood what I was saying in that list, I will note that many thought I was critiquing certain games, and that's not true at all. Food Chain Magnet is one of my favorite board games of all time. It is in my top 10 board games of all time. It is a game that I thoroughly, thoroughly enjoy. I just think it costs more than it does, more than it should, relative to the enjoyment. But Food Chain Magnet, why do I love this game so much? I love this game because it is barely a Euro. It is a Euro. You are converting goods. You are getting more stuff in order to do more stuff and sell your items and market your items. It is incredible. But it is economic warfare. This is not a game where you are simply building your engine and hoping you build a better engine than your opponent. This is a game where you sit there and you say, I'm going to market Coke. I'm going to market that drink because I want the people to buy it. And so your opponent swoops in and pivots their production and they stop producing burgers because burgers are no longer in chic. They're no longer in style. They're no longer wanted. And now they need to up their resource production. Meanwhile, another opponent jumps in and says, I can't produce enough drinks, so I'm not going to bother. Instead, I will change the advertising game. I will start running radio ads across the board so that people instead want pizza. And at the same time, I'm going to up my pizza production. You are constantly pivoting and adjusting to the economic maneuvers that your opponent places in front of you. Food Chain Magnet is the furthest thing from a multiplayer solo game, multiplayer solo, I'm losing my terms here, but it is a game where every move you make is so key. Every move you make has to be a response to your opponent in order to pivot and adjust so that you have a reasonable chance of winning this game, because trust me, you do want to win this game. It is fun. It feels rewarding to walk to the end of that game and to sit there and say, look how I pivoted, look how I outmaneuvered. And Food Chain Magnet is, well, it's just an incredible experience. Next up, we have Brass Lancashire. Brass is an amazing game. It's amazing. It's incredible. I haven't played Birmingham. I get that question a lot. I need to. But I have played Brass, and I've played the original Blast. I've played Age of Industry, and now I've played Brass Lancashire. And this game is one of Martin Wallace's finest games, and this particular edition is when Roxley took it to the next step. Roxley took this game, took an incredible gameplay experience, and bundled it in gorgeous art, beautifully produced components. Those chips are, those iron clays are incredible. But this game, it is so good. It combines so many different aspects of building buildings in a certain order in order to do what you need to do. You have to be on top of the various production of coal and lead, of iron, in order to maximize what the game is trying to do. You have to be aware of the situations on the board, the spots on the board. You have to be aware of the multiple ages of the game, the multiple phases of play, building both for now as well as for the future, connecting your areas, building your engines, accelerating your building production. It is a game where you can take out loans in order to push yourself further. It is, every move in this game is tight. It is simultaneously one of the more beautifully produced games that I own, while also being one of the tightest Euro engines in any economic game that I have on my table. And that is why I love Brass, and that is why I need to play Brass Birmingham eventually, because from everything I've heard, Brass Birmingham is possibly better, which seems hard considering how amazing Brass is, but hey, that's why I have both. Next up from there, we have Castles of Burgundy, the oldest game in my collection on this list. Although, technically, this is the 20th anniversary edition, so I don't know if you can call it the oldest game in my collection, but the original Castles is. Castles of Burgundy is a game from Stefan Feld, and it's one of two Stefan Feld games on this list. But Castles of Burgundy is, to me, the epitome of his designs. It is possibly the best game I have played from Stefan Feld, possibly one of the best games I have played ever. It plays great with 2 and 3 players, a little bit of a slog with 4, but it is an engine that consistently, despite being decade old, it is a game that consistently, wait, is it decades? This is the 20th anniversary? I don't know what I'm doing here. I can't remember, is it decades old? I don't know. This is a good game. Castles of Burgundy is an excellent game where you are building out your city, where every single turn you have to roll the dice and then allocate those dice to different engines. Do you want to acquire a tile? Do you want to place a tile into your board? Do you want to sell a tile? Do you want to sell goods? Do you want to trade your die for more workers so you have more flexibility and maneuvering in the next turn? It is a game where you are constantly choosing. Every game is a choice between what you will specialize in. Farmland is excellent because it can accelerate points if you build it up correctly, but science will give you abilities that will make all your other choices throughout the game better and more powerful. The buildings in general are just jack of all trades. They do a little bit of everything and can help tweak your strategy in different directions. Or do you go more on first turn order and building up goods so you can consistently turn those in for points? There are so many different strategies in this game, so many different ways you can win, and every single time it is amazing how this game consistently delivers on an experience years later, years down the road. I've got this game back in 2012 and it's still in my collection. This is one of my original, literally one of my first 10 board games that I ever bought, and it is still in my collection. And there's not a lot of games left in my collection that are that old. Next up on the list, we have Terraforming Mars. Terraforming Mars is almost the reverse of Brass, although they are fixing that. What I mean by that is Terraforming Mars is a game that, it is an incredible gameplay experience, but it is one of the worst arts components from a game of this caliber, although to some extent, not to a large extent, to some extent they are fixing that with the big box that they just recently had on Kickstarter, so we'll have a much more premium gameplay experience, but the art will still be terrible clip art that looks like, well, it doesn't look good, I'll tell you that much. Terraforming Mars, I love because of two things. First of all, I will say this off the bat. If you are someone who has played Terraforming Mars and you have not enjoyed it, please tell me you have played it with drafting. Please tell me you have, because drafting to me makes this game go from a solid 8 straight to a 10. Without drafting, I enjoy it. I think it's a great engine. I think it's good. But drafting adds that additional tension to the game that is necessary to stop complaining about the luck of the cards you were dealt and the luck of the hand. And it adds that tension of there are 4 cards in your hand and you have to figure out which of these are you keeping and which of these are you passing to your opponent, even though you know he's pursuing a plan strategy and giving him this card will be incredible. Or maybe you're passing to your left because your opponent will, she's going to use that asteroid to destroy your. It is consistently a good game. It is better with drafting. In Terraforming Mars, you are terraforming Mars. That's what you're doing. You're trying to terraform Mars through the acceleration of the oxygen, through water levels, and through atmosphere. Heat. And in the game, you're consistently acquiring cards to build up your engine. It's a tableau building game because all the cards you get, some of them will be one-time use abilities, others will give you ongoing effects, but they will consistently build your engine more and more, and you have to constantly wrestle. One of my favorite mechanics of this game is the idea that every card you get doesn't have to be a card you keep, and in fact, the cards you choose to keep in your hand, you are paying for. So yes, that is a cool card. Yes, that will be useful in a few decades from now. But are you willing to give up valuable resources now to keep the promise of the future? And that is a risky game to play, and it's a game that I lose every single time I play this game. I consistently get better at not picking all the cards, but better is not good enough. I still always bite off more than I can chew because the cards are so pretty, and they will ultimately combo well with whatever I get next, but that's only if I can afford to build it all, and sadly in this game, I just can't. And that's unfortunate, it is what it is, but ultimately Terraforming Mars delivers a tight experience full of tough decisions, and I have basically every expansion in here, although I've only played with a few of them. But yeah, I recommend Terraforming Mars, although I do recommend it with the drafting variant. From there, we will add Le Havre. Le Havre is my only Uwe Rosenberg game on this list. I have gone through a lot of Uwe games over the years, and I still have a few more in my collection, but only one of them is making its way onto this list. And that is Le Havre, which to me still delivers the pinnacle of an Uwe game. I really like this game, and the reason for that is it plays well with a variety of player counts. I think it's best with 2 and 3, but in this game, you are consistently going through moving ships along the harbor while trying to acquire resources, and every turn, you consistently have to make choices between taking up the accelerating piles of resources versus building buildings versus going into those buildings, taking advantage of the buildings. This is the original to me, the original game of Turn This Into That. And while Turn This Into That has consistently been done again and again in games, and it has been done in very creative ways, there are so many games that take advantage of the Turn This Into That. It's a simple mechanism, right? It's a simple mechanic. But Le Havre still does it incredibly well to this day. And what I love those cards that you had to add in each game that make the game slightly different, that mix it up slightly each single time you play. There are slight adjustments you'll have to make to what you thought was a locked-in strategy because you have to pivot around the changes in those cards. That's a mechanic that Uwe did in Agricola as well, by giving a few cards that make it so that you never can lock in the perfect strategy. And for me, I personally prefer Le Havre, but they both do it well, and Le Havre, it's a great game. I highly recommend I recommend everything on this list. I don't know what I'm doing here anymore. From there, next up, we have, let's pick another game from this side. We have Bruges. Bruges is my second Stefanfeld game on this list, and Bruges is one that, like Evadel, is one that I got rid of and got back. And Bruges in particular is one that's actually currently being reprinted as Hamburg by Queen Games. They're doing a reprint of this game. So this one's out of print, but you can get the new one. The new one does have changes. I am skeptical that the changes are better. I think I'm keeping Bruges, but I am open-minded. I will try out the new one as well. I'll try out Hamburg. But why do I like Bruges so much? In Bruges, the reason I love it is every single round you are dealt a new hand of cards. Effectively, you can hold over some cards from previous rounds, but ultimately every round you are drawing more cards. And those cards are going to each card, unlike Le Havre, which will give you a few different cards every game that mix it up. In Bruges, every single round, you have to adjust and pivot your strategy to match whatever the hand was dealt, to match whatever cards were placed into your hand that turn. You may have thought you were going one way, but you have to pivot and adjust because you just got four new cards that will completely change up what makes the most sense at this moment. Every single round is trying to maximize, to min-max, to see what you can do based on the current board state, based on the current set of cards in your hand, but you have to be flexible. It is planning for the future while adjusting to the moment. I love that so much in this game. Hamburg, the re-implementation, does attempt to slightly minimize the amount of luck in the game to give you a little more consistency, which I value in theoretically from what it's doing, but I think I like it in its current implementation. I consistently enjoy this game. I've played it in person, I've played it on Yukata. Every single time it delivers a solid experience, and it delivers that in an hour. Generally, it's a pretty consistent hour-long game with 3, 4, or 5 players. I think it's best with 3 and 4, but it is still an enjoyable experience even with 5, although the game slows down a little bit. The expansions to me are a no-brainer. The Hamburg does come with the expansions built in. In Bruges, they have the City on the Zwin, which is an expansion that's a modular expansion, but I recommend basically almost all the modules. They add and don't really detract in any notable way. And next up from there, we have Coimbra. Coimbra, oh my gosh, Coimbra. Coimbra is one of my favorite, well, again, I keep doing that. These are all my favorite games. They're all my favorite games. Coimbra is an incredible, same with the words. I'm running out of good words here. Coimbra is a game where there are multiple elements at play. There are multiple things that you have to be mindful of in this game. Ultimately, it is a dice drafting game. You roll the dice, and then you slowly, one at a time, pick the dice and allocate them to certain tracks. How you allocate the dice will determine so many different things in this game. It will determine the cost of the cards you acquire. It will determine which cards you can acquire, how much you're going to pay for them, in what order you're going to pay for them, what rewards you will take later, because the dice are all colored, and when you place them, it will determine what and how much you pay for things, or when and how much you pay for things. But then later in the round, it will come back because you will take rewards based on how far up certain tracks you have gone. This is a game that intermingles three or four different key elements of gameplay in different ways that truly make you feel like you have to make hard choices at every single turn. It is a game that consistently delivers an incredible experience. It is a game that I cannot tell you how much I feel that tension every single time I have to make a difficult choice in this game. Coimbra is... I am looking forward to an expansion to Coimbra. I don't actually think it needs an expansion because of how tight it is, but it is a game that is tight in the choices that it gives you every single time. Which brings us to Troyes. Troyes, or Troyes, as I always say Troyes because I believe that's how you pronounce it, but I always feel like I have to explain that because it looks like Troyes. But Troyes is a game that is another dice game in this... I'm getting a little crowded in here by these boxes. Troyes is a game that is another dice game. It is a game where you are consistently making choices. This is the only one I debated leaving off this list because it's not as much of an economic engine as many of the others. At the same time, it is tight in its gameplay. Every single move you make is slowly accelerating what you can do because every single round, you are slowly able to place workers on different cards, giving you abilities that you didn't otherwise have. You have access to these abilities that will lock in an engine of how you turn one thing into another, of how you most manipulate the board state. Are you going to roll a bunch of yellow dice and then convert them into resources? Are you going to take advantage of the fact that you have a placement in the church, in the chapel or whatnot? Are you going to sit there and try to defend this city from being overrun by the invaders? But in the meantime, every single round, as you slowly but surely acquire dice and better your position in this game, you're going to roll those dice, but your opponents can take them from you. Worse than that, they don't even have to pay you for the privilege. They have to pay the bank, but not you. So you're going to be rolling more and more dice, but also giving them up to your opponent, which sounds like it's annoying, but in reality it works out well because a single player getting too many dice of a type, a single player getting too locked in on a competitive advantage, isn't actually nearly as good as you think because they are always vulnerable to having those dice taken away from them. At the same time, because of the way the game works, your dice can be combined, but you have to pay more and more in order to lock in dice for a more powerful combined action. The way this game thrives is because you are consistently choosing how to best utilize your limited actions, how to best utilize your limited people and your limited money, your limited resources, and most importantly, your limited dice in order to do what works for you, in order to take advantage. You're going to constantly be balancing multiple resources from money, from favor, from dice, and then managing those all with a degree of worker placement in this game. Troyes, or Troyes, is one of my favorite... I can't stop doing this, I apologize. Troyes is an incredible game that is worth getting. It is an incredible game that is worth playing again and again and again. And I do recommend the expansion, The Ladies of Troyes, because it will add more. What will happen is, as you play this game, it will be great, it will be incredible, but over time, over multiple plays, that will slowly feel a little bit repetitive. You'll see too many of the same cards come out, and you'll start thinking that you've not necessarily solved, but you start figuring out patterns that work for you, and adding the Ladies of Troyes in, or even the bonus cards, an additional small expansion, will mix that up so much, because then you will start seeing fewer and fewer repetitive combinations appear in your game. You will have to consistently adjust to new and more strategies as different cards enter the mix, as different cards, because what happens is in the game, there are a handful of cards that are added in every single game. There's 9 cards in each game in 3 different colors, in 3 different factions, in white, in yellow, and red, which is warfare, economic, and white's more of this point-based catch-all mechanism that affects different things. But you'll have 9 total cards, and those 9 total cards will, in the first few rounds, you'll unlock 3 cards, the next round you'll unlock 3 more, and the third round you'll unlock 3, and then the last few rounds you have all those cards. And so the variety of cards you can add to this game are key, because they really drive the main mechanism is the same across the game, those cards mix up how the main mechanism adjusts itself to the gameplay, and the variety is key. That being said, give Troyes a shot. It's consistently a game that's on sale, even now. I mean, not now, but it's a game that I'll still see on sale here and there. If you pay attention to Amazon or wherever, you'll see it available cheaply, and it's a game you should definitely get. And finally, last on this list, we have Concordia. Concordia, which, by the way, we have a bunch of these boxes, the standard box sizes, and then, of course, Concordia, which is neither of those in the standard box domain. Concordia is by Matt Gertz, and it's a game that had to be on this list, although I did consider a few more, including Navigator, but Concordia is more of a classic turn this into that or economic engine. In Concordia, what you are doing is It takes Matt Gertz, who's usually known for his rondelles. In Concordia, he mixed it up. He decided instead to go with a card system that is brilliant. And other games have done it, but I think I love it. I think I like its implementation best in Concordia. Every turn, you will play a card to take an action on that card. And then at a certain point, you can play one of the cards that will bring all your cards back into your hand, as well as giving you a little money along the way. But during the course of the game, you can add more cards to your hand, so it gives you more longevity before you have to pull back. But the core actions on those cards will consistently make you decide, well, what do I do this turn? Do I try to build more buildings? Do I try to, you know, build some, get, acquire some resources? Do I produce? Do I get my cards back? Do I buy more cards? There are so many different actions you choose, and the order in which you try to stagger your turns, every single time you feel challenged by the fact that, well, I want to do this so I can do this more efficiently, but instead I can do this so I can do that more efficiently, or I can do this so I can do that more efficiently. Every single choice in this game is going to make every single subsequent action in other domains more efficient. But you have to figure out the sequencing that makes sense for you. And you're going to be, as the game progresses, you're going to be building along a board and slowly but surely adding various locations to the board so that you can have more of an effect in production, so you can have more of a benefit and reward from production. But it is so hard to manage those challenges as the game progresses. This is a game that comes with multiple expansions that have small adjustments to gameplay, add more maps, and then of course there's Concordia Venus, which adds a whole new style to that gameplay. Concordia is, it is one, if I had to pick one game from this list to recommend, it likely would be Concordia. Not because it's my personal favorite, but because I think it does have that hybrid of the best level of accessibility combined with a huge amount of decision trees in the game. It is the closest thing to a gateway game on this list, perhaps with the exception of Evadel. And as I've said, Evadel is a little trickier because of that first play and juggling that first play and how it plays out. That is basically it. Those are my top 10 favorite Euro games, specifically those in with an economic bend to them. But I would say as well, I will note that because this is a Euro list, I would be remiss if I didn't mention that you should check out Last Light by Roy Canaday from the Dice Tower. Last Light is a new game coming out by Roy Canaday. It is supposed to be one of the most incredible Euros out there. It's an incredible experience. There seems to be some debate as to exactly what genre it's in. I know Roy believes that it might be more, not so much a Euro, but if you look, anyone from Eric Lang to whoever acknowledges that this is an incredible Euro game, and it's one well worth checking out. Look into Last Light, see if it's for you. I believe they're currently doing tabletop simulator plays of it if you want to check it out. But yeah, basically check out Last Light. I'm hoping it'll add to this list of great Euros in my collection. Until next time, I am Alex Radcliffe from Board Game Co. I hope you enjoy this list. Let me know what I left off. If I like these games, what am I missing? If you like half these games, you like half these games, and you think these are all incredible, what should I be trying next? And then I'll let you know. Maybe I own it already, maybe I played it and didn't like it, or maybe it's another game that I have to add to my collection. I always like finding additional games, and when you guys tell me about them, it helps. Until next time, I am Alex Radcliffe from Board Game Co., and have a good one.